वेलकम स्टूडेंट्स फॉर सीए फाइनल मे 2017 अटेम्प्ट आईसीएआई हैज इश्यूड रिलेवेंट केस लॉ बुक इन दैट फॉर कस्टम्स इन ऑल देर आर 24 केस लॉज दिस वीडियो इज फॉर दोज 24 केस लॉज द मटेरियल फॉर द सेम इज अवेलेबल इन डाउनलोड सेक्शन इन द मटेरियल यू हैव टू चॉइसेस वन अ मटेरियल विथ डिटेल्ड स्टडी ऑफ द केस लॉ Full possible text for the case law has been given. That is one choice. Secondly, also some summary has been attached. Either you should have looked at the full detailed study material or you should have looked at the summary, whatever you are comfortable with. But let it be the summary or the detailed case law. Some markings you are going to find here. For example, the first case law. Tirupati Udyog Limited 2011 Andhra Pradesh. One marking you can see is that it has already come in May 2012 attempt. This is one information available to you. As you can understand, the one case law which has already come should be less important over others. The second marking which you can observe is here. For example, for the second case law Mangalore Refinery and Petrochemicals Limited 2015 Supreme Court. While taking this case law in case law book, Institute has borrowed it from RTP May 2016. In these case laws, in all 24, wherever you see something like this, either it is taken from RTP May 2016, not by me, by the Institute. Institute has copy-pasted this case law from RTP May 2016. These case laws should be more important over others. That's it. So, two kind of marking you can see. Whether that particular case law has already come in the examination is mentioned separately or if it is copy pasted from RTP, it is shown separately. This will decide for you to decide the priorities or what is more important over others. That's it. And again, as far as material is concerned, two sets of material is available. If time is not a problem, you can have a look at my detailed study material or if time is a problem, you can restrict yourself to the summary. That's it. So let us start. Yes. First case law is about Tirupati Udyog Limited 2011 Andhra Pradesh. Before we read this case law, if you remember, similar case law we have already studied in classroom condition in our book. The name of that case law was SR Steel Limited 2010 Supreme Court. This case law and Tirupati Udyog Limited, they have the same facts and same answer. So let us remember what the case law is all about. The question is, suppose there is a SEZ and there is a DTA unit and DTA unit has sold goods to SEZ. As you know, normally there is nothing like export duties in this world because we have accepted destination based principle of taxation. In destination based principle of taxation, we say that we should export goods and services and we should not export taxes. So normally there is nothing like export duty. But sometimes export duty is introduced not from revenue point of view but from control point of view. Now suppose DTA unit has sold goods, some goods to SEZ and surprisingly for example these goods attract export duty. Now the question is if DTA has sold goods to SEZ whether export duty will be payable? That is the question. Suppose these particular goods which DTA has sold to SEZ, suppose they attract export duty, whether in this transaction, whether export duty is payable, that is the question. And what the court has said is like this. As far as SEZ Act is concerned, it is silent on this issue. Whether DTA selling goods to SEZ, whether it is export, SEZ Act is silent on this issue. As far as Customs Act is concerned, we say it is export if it is taken to place outside India. And what is place outside India? Beyond 12 nautical miles. And SEZ is within those 12 nautical miles. So, from the Customs Act also, DTA selling goods to SEZ is not an export. Conclusion, as SEZ Act is silent on this issue and as per Customs Act, this does not amount to export. Hence, no export duty is payable. That is the first case law, Tirupati Udyog Limited, 2011, Andhra Pradesh.
Now, let us do the 10th case law. It is Mangalore Refinery and Petrochemicals Limited. The case law is saying, in case of import of crude oil, whether custom duty is payable on the basis of quantity of oil shown in the bill of lading or the actual quantity received into shore tanks in India. Just to give an example, suppose we have ordered 10,000 liters of oil. But when it was unloaded and when it was received in India, for example, it was only 9,500 liters. Now, whether import duty is payable on the quantity shown in bill of lading or whether on actual quantity received in India. What is correct answer? That is the discussion which is given in the Mangalore Refinery and Petrochemicals Limited. Before we study the conclusion, what is held in this case law, let us try to remember something. Let us try to remember Section 13. Section 13 was talking about pilferage. If you remember, if goods are pilfered while in the custody of Port Trust Authority, importer is not required to pay import duty on that. So, if goods are pilfered, import duty is not payable. Also, try to remember Section 23. Section 23 was talking about remission of import duty. If before clearance for home consumption, that is when goods are at Port Trust Authorities or when the goods are in warehouse, but before their clearance for home consumption, if goods are lost and destroyed because of any reasons, you have to complete certain procedure of remission, and under Section 23(1) remission will be granted and you need not pay import duty. So in other words, having read Section 13 and Section 23(1) constructively, logic is very simple. Import duty become payable only on those goods which become available for home consumption in India. Also, try to remember what is definition of import as per Customs Act. Here, I have reproduced that definition. Import means bringing into India and place from place outside India. And if you remember garden silk milk, here garden silk milk case law I have given in small font because it was not discussed in the case law at all. This is just a value addition from me. But if you remember garden silk milk, the garden silk milk said import of goods commences when they enter TWI. It is complete when goods become part of mass of goods in India, and taxable event is when you file bill of entry for home consumption. So import is complete only when on payment of duty goods are cleared from custom barrier. And which is the taxable event? Taxable event is filing of bill of entry for home consumption. So if 9,500 liters are received, then importer will file bill of entry for home consumption only for 9,500 liters, and obviously import duty will be payable only on 9,500 liters. All these arguments go in favor of the fact that import duty is not payable on value, on quantity shown in bill of lading, but it is payable on quantity that is actually cleared for home consumption. Having said that, all those sections I have given here as discussion, let us understand, let us read the decision together. The court, it was held, quantity actually received in the shore tank in India should be the basis for payment of duty. Import duty can only be on imported goods, that is on goods brought into India from place outside India. Till that is done, there is no charge of tax. So only import duty will become payable on goods that become available for home consumption. The taxable event in the case of imported goods is import. And import is when you file, what is the taxable event is given by Garden Silk Mill. Taxable event is when importer files bill of entry for home consumption. Under Section 13 and Section 23 of the Act, where goods which are imported are lost, pilfered or destroyed, no import duty is levyable. Court says that the tribunal's reasoning that somehow when custom duty is ad valorem basis for arriving at quantity of the goods imported changes is wholly unsustainable. Whether duty is ad valorem or whether duty is specific duty, that is not creating charge of the duty. It is only method of payment of duty. If it is ad valorem, it is percentage of value, and if it is specific, it is amount payable per unit. But that is not creating charge. Just because in a particular case it is ad valorem or it is specific, that will not change the situation. Ad valorem or specific is method of percentage. It is not charging section. All reasoning read together, very clear that import duty will be payable only on goods, the quantity which becomes available for consumption in India. That is the case law of Mangalore Refinery and Petrochemicals Limited, 2015 Supreme Court. Number 25, case law number 25, IDEC Tourism Services Private Limited, 2015 Supreme Court. We are actually experts of this. When goods are imported in India, what all duties are payable? BCD is payable, 3-1 is payable, EC of custom is payable, SHEC of custom is payable, and 3-5 is payable. What is 3-1? 3-1 is countervailing duty, which countervails the effect of excise duty. If goods are manufactured in India, what would have been excise duty liability on these goods? Same, we are putting equal as 3-1. So 3-1 is nothing but for 1 minute, custom officer forgets that goods are imported goods. He asks himself a question, what would have been excise duty liability if the same goods would have been manufactured in India? And that he puts as custom duty, that is 3-1. So Central Excise Tariff Act, suppose we have imported FP1, and on FP1, as per CETA, total excise duty payable is 12.5%. Then 3-1 will be equal to 12.5%, because 3-1 is nothing but what would have been excise duty liability if the imported goods, same goods, were manufactured in India. That is 3-1. But now I change my example. We have imported FP1. As per CETA, FP1 is 12.5%. But under section 5A1 of Central Excise Act, some exemption notification has been issued and it is 100% exempt. So if you are manufacturing FP1 in India, CETA read with exemption notification, effective excise duty is nil. So now, if I imported FP1, what should be 3-1 equal to? And the answer is nil. The question is, would countervailing duty, CVD, on any imported product be exempted if excise duty on like article produced or manufactured in India is exempt? Answer is yes. If under section 5A1, because some exemption notification is issued, which is 100%, net of exemption, CETA read with exemption notification, if effective excise duty liability is nil, then 3-1 will be equal to nil. In other words, exemption notifications are already also applicable when calculating 3-1. That is the case law. I think in the classroom condition, we already developed the expertise of this case law. Please read the answer yourself. This is case law number 25 on page number 25.
Next case law is Kehlin Pentalpha Limited, 2012 Supreme Court. A very simple issue. There was a dispute between the department and the SSC. We are talking about exact classification of electronic automatic regulators. What is the exact classification? There was a dispute between department and the SSC. Department was saying that the correct classification is 8543.89, the chapter number, code number, and SSC was saying that correct classification is in chapter 9032.89. The dispute was on for some period. Meanwhile, on 1st March 2002, central government issued one exemption notification. If you remember, in service tax, exemptions are issued under section 93. In excise, they are issued under section 5A. And in customs, their parallel section is section 25. Under section 25, on 1st March 2002, central government issued one exemption notification. And in that exemption notification, it was stated that electronic automatic regulators, which fall in 9032.89. Please understand, exemption issued by central government, and central government in its own exemption notification is accepting that electronic automatic regulators fall in 9032.89. I think dispute is over. when central government itself accepts in an exemption notification that a particular item falls into a particular classification, revenue department cannot challenge it any further and the case is closed. That is what is the case law. In this case law, it was held, the apex court observed that central government had issued an exemption notification dated 1st March 2002 and in the said notification, it had classified the electronic automatic regulators under chapter subheading 9032.89. Since the revenue itself classified the goods in dispute under chapter subheading 9032 from 1st March 2002, the said classification needs to be accepted by the department and the department needs to accept it retrospectively. That is the case law. Please study this case law.
Next case law, 26 number, highly fact-based case law, a classification issue, Nokia India Private Limited, 2015 Supreme Court. Question is whether mobile battery charger is an accessory or part. Let us read what is held first. The apex court held that mobile battery charger is an accessory to mobile phone and not an integral part of it. So whether the question is whether battery charger whether is an accessory or part of mobile phone. The decision, I'll read it once again. The apex court held that mobile battery charger is an accessory to mobile phone and not integral part of it. In the discussion, the arguments given, I have given, I'll read them for you. Discussion. The battery charger is not a part of a mobile cell phone but an accessory to it on the basis of following observations. Had the charger been a part of cell phone could not have been operated without using the battery charger. You can use mobile phone without battery charger on. Only when you want to charge your battery, that time only you fix it, but otherwise independently you keep on using mobile phone. That is the first argument. Had the charger been part of cell phone could not have been operated without using the battery charger. However, as a matter of fact, it is not required at the time of operation. When you use mobile phone actually, that time you don't require a charger. Second, matlab 1B, the battery in the cell phone can be charged directly from other means also like a laptop without employing battery charger. Sometimes, in the case of emergency, you can charge your mobile phone without using charger by using a laptop. That is the second argument. Third argument, as per information available on the website SSE, it had been put mobile battery charger in the category of accessory. On his site, SSE himself also is showing mobile phone as an accessory, the charger as an accessory. Third, a particular model of Nokia make battery charger was compatible with many models of Nokia phone chargers. Same charger can be used for most of the other models of Nokia mobile phones also. So interchangeable, if it is Nokia mobile phone, by using any other model charger you can charge your own mobile phone. They are interchangeable. Rule 3B of general rules of interpretation can also not be applied in the SSE's case, as merely making a composite package of cell phone and mobile battery charger will not make a composite good for the purpose of interpretation of the provisions. Having said all this, the court has given decision that charger is an accessory and not the part. Highly fact-based questions, Nokia India Private Limited, 2015 Supreme Court.
Next case law. It's CPS Textiles Private Limited, 2010 Madras. A very simple case law once again. For example, in a particular case, SSE filed shipping bill. Example, SSE filed shipping bill and in his shipping bill, he classified imported goods as chemical X. Now, department will have to accept this classification. If department wants to challenge this classification, and if department thinks that it is not chemical X, for example, department thinks that it is chemical Y, what department will have to do? Department will have to substantiate its claim why department wants to classify it as chemical Y. This can be done either by performing test For example, sample of chemical X can be removed, it can be sent to the laboratory, a laboratory report can be received which substantiates that it's not chemical X but it's chemical Y. Or in the absence, other option is department will have to conduct inquiries. For example, department talks to the supplier manufacturer, asks some more information from him, and based on that information, department can prove that the correct classification is not chemical X, it can be chemical Y. But anyway, if department wants to change the classification done by the SSE, the classification done by the SSE as per shipping bill, if department wants to challenge that, just erroneously department cannot change the classification. If department wants to change the classification, it has to be substantiated by some evidence, like for example, the examples which I gave, by performance of test or by conducting inquiries. That is the first fact. The first fact is that will the description of the goods as per document submitted along with shipping bill be relevant criteria for the purpose of classification, if not otherwise disputed on the basis of any technical option or test. So, if department is challenging the classification and changing the classification, department will have to substantiate it by some evidence. That is the first case, first result. And secondly, whether a separate notice is required to be issued for payment of interest, which is mandatory and automatically applies to recovery of excess drawback. If you remember, section 75A deals with the interest, and in 75A2, it is already well written that at any point of time, if duty drawback is held erroneous, it will be always recovered from the SSE and it will be always recovered with interest. When the section is loud and clear, whether or not interest is payable, I think that issue is sorted out. Always, whenever drawback is recovered, it will be always recovered with interest. Separate notice for recovery of interest is not required. That is the case law, CPS Textiles Private Limited, 2010, Madras.
I am on page 27, Gira Enterprises, 2014 Supreme Court. Under section 14 of Customs Act, when importer files bill of entry for home consumption and he has filed valuation declaration along with that, officer will scrutinize that. If all conditions are satisfied and if officer is of the opinion that the value declared by the importer is full value, the transparent value, officer may accept it as value for import duty purpose. In that case, section 14.1 will say accessible value is equal to transaction value, and subject to adjustments under rule 10, assessment will be completed. But if according to officer, if value is suppressed, he will reject the valuation and then will shift to custom valuation rules. First rule and the obvious rule is rule 4, identical value. Here, officer will have access to the information at and around same time. The value for which identical or similar goods are imported, that value officer will take as value of goods under consideration. But while doing this, he has to depend on available evidence. That evidence should be transparent, evidence should be readily available. Also, the assumptions and the proof based on which officer is trying to complete the assessment under rule 4, those assumptions have to be forwarded to the importer. He should be allowed to take view of that information. He should be given opportunity of being heard, and then assessment can be completed under rule 4. Here, officer rejected value of imported goods. He did it based on one computer printout which he got from customs department. Just based on one computer printout, he rejected the value. That computer printout showed the higher value. Just based on that printout, officer rejected the value and he proceeded to complete the assessment under rule 4. Obviously, SSE demanded, give me the copy of that printout so that I can put up my case. But officer was never able to or never give him the copy of that printout, and straight away he completed the assessment. Is it acceptable? The answer is no. I'll read the answer here. The value of imported goods could not be enhanced on such basis. Mere existence of alleged computer printout was not proof of existence of comparable imports. Even if assumed that such printout did exist and content thereof were true, Such printout must have been supplied to the appellant and it should have been given reasonable opportunity to establish that import transactions were not comparable. In absence of these two, this addition value was rejected. That is the case law, Gira Enterprises 2014 Supreme Court. Absolutely natural justice ke principles ke basis ke upar question hai. सिंपल इश्यू है, एक बार पढ़ लेना, गिरा एंटरप्राइजेस 2014 सुप्रीम कोर्ट.
नेक्स्ट केस लॉ इज श्रीजी ओवरसीज इंडिया प्राइवेट लिमिटेड 2013 गुजरात. अगेन अ वेरी सिंपल केस लॉ. फर्स्ट आई विल लाइक टू रिमाइंड यू अबाउट सेक्शन 48. व्हाट इज सेक्शन 48? आफ्टर गुड्स आर अनलोडेड विद पोर्ट ट्रस्ट अथॉरिटीज, आइदर दे शुड बी क्लियर्ड फॉर होम कंजम्पशन और दे शुड बी ट्रांसफर्ड टू द वेयर हाउस और importer should relinquish the title or they should be transshipped. If none of this thing happens and if 30 days are over, port trust authorities will give notice to the importer, will take permission from custom officer and they will auction the goods. That is what is written in section 48. So section 48 says after goods are unloaded with the port trust authorities, you have to clear them within 30 days, otherwise port trust authorities will auction the goods. Now I am talking about section 46. If you are an importer and you come to know that your goods have been unloaded with port trust authorities, you will file bill of entry. You will file bill of entry for home consumption or you will file bill of entry for warehousing. Either, but it is always filed under section 46. If you read section 46 carefully, there is no mention of time limit. So, after goods are unloaded with the port trust authorities, there is no time limit prescribed under section 46 within which you have to file bill of entry. Now, the question is, the time limit given by section 48, can it be read into section 46? Whether it can be read into, see, logically it is very acceptable that if you are not filing bill of entry under section 46, then port trust authorities will auction your goods under section 48. That is true. Logically, that limit will become applicable to section 46 also. But on plain reading of section 46, whether section 46 has given any time limit for clearance of the goods, answer is no. The limit given by section 48 of 30 days cannot be read into section 46. That is the case law, a very obvious case law. Shriji Overseas India Private Limited, 2013, Gujarat. Next case law. Honestly, I have nothing to value add in this case law, so I am going to read it as it is for you. Is the adjudicating authority required to supply to the SSE copies of the documents on which it proposes to place reliance for the purpose of re-quantification of short levy of the customs duty? Chemtech International Private Limited, 2013 Supreme Court. For the purpose of re-quantification of short levy of custom duty, the adjudicating authority, following the principle of natural justice, should supply to the SSE all the documents on which it proposes to place its reliance. Therefore, the SSE might furnish the explanation thereon and might provide additional evidence in support of their claim. It is absolutely based on principles of natural justice if department is proceeding against the SSE and that proceedings are based on certain documents. As a natural justice, those copies of the document should be made available to the SSE so that he can prepare his arguments, he can create some evidences and give presentation to the department so that after being opportunity of being heard, the demand can be given. But certainly giving copies of those documents based on natural justice is a compulsory, a very simple case law, Chemtech International Private Limited, 2013 Supreme Court. Next case law is Tucker Shipping Private Limited, 2012 Supreme Court. Before we read this case law, let us try to remember and revise what is the review procedure we have learnt in classroom condition. And what we have learnt is like this. If adjudicating officer is of the lower level authority, by lower level I mean below the commissioner level, so joint commissioner, additional commissioner, assistant commissioner, deputy commissioner or superintendent or inspectors. If adjudication is done by lower level authority, one copy of adjudicating order, they gave it to the commissioner And if commissioner is of the opinion that particular part of that order is against interest of the revenue, then he will mark that and give it back. And lower level officer against his own order will go in appeal to commissioner appeals. Commissioner appeal will listen to it like any other order and review is complete. If basic adjudication order is passed by commissioner, he will give one copy to committee of chief commissioners. Committee of chief commissioner will study the adjudicating order passed by the commissioner, and if they are of the opinion that that order is against interest of the revenue, they will mark it back, and commissioner against his own order will go to CSTAT, and CSTAT will listen to it like any other appeal and the review is complete, and CSTAT will give the decision and review is complete. That was the second review. And third review, any order passed by commissioner appeal, he will be giving copy to committee of commissioners. Committee of commissioner will take review of order passed by commissioner appeal, and if they are of the opinion that order is prejudiced to the interest of the revenue, they will mark it back to the adjudicating officer, and it will be heard by CSTAT, and CSTAT will give decision and review is complete. So there are basically three types of reviews. Here we are concerned, in this particular case law, we are concerned with adjudicating order passed by commissioner, which is reviewed by the committee of chief commissioner. Now what happens is like this: committee of chief commissioner reviewed the order passed by commissioner. They were of the opinion that it is against the interest of the revenue. They wanted that commissioner should go to CSTAT. CSTAT commissioner also filed the appeal, but he filed the appeal late. Now the question is whether this delay in filing the appeal, whether this delay can be condoned by CSTAT. Whether CSTAT can condone the delay is written in section 129A5. There they have written, the appellate tribunal, CSTAT, may admit an appeal or permit the filing of a memorandum of cross objections after the expiry of the relevant period referred to in subsection 3 or subsection 4 if it is satisfied that there was sufficient cause for not presenting it within that period. Whether CSTAT's right to condone the delay is equally available to appeal filed by the commissioner under review, and the answer is yes. It was held, High Court ruled that tribunal was competent to invoke section 129A5 where an application under section 129D4 had not been made within the prescribed time, and condones the delay in making such application if it was satisfied that there was sufficiency of cause for not presenting it within that period. The question is, if assessee is filing the appeal late, whether that delay can be condoned by CSTAT? Answer is yes. Also, if commissioner under review files the appeal late, whether that delayed appeal, the lateness, can it also be condoned by the CSTAT? And the answer is yes. That is the case law, Thakkar Shipping Private Limited, 2012 Supreme Court. Next case law has already come in May 2014. It is Univert Textiles Limited, 2013 Supreme Court. Basically, we already know this, that extended period of limitation can be invoked if non-payment, short payment, non-levy, short levy, or erroneous refund, as the case may be, was by reason of fraud, collusion, misrepresentation, suppression of fact, or any act or omission with intent to evade the duty. So, extended period of limitation can be invoked only if suppression or fraud was involved, and not when assessee is bona fide. Here, the question was applicability of one exemption notification. Assessee was confused about it. Assessee was confused whether or not that exemption is applicable to him. So, because he is from textile industry, he wrote to the Development Commissioner of Textiles. He wrote to the Development Commissioner of Textiles and asked his opinion about whether this exemption is applicable. The Development Commissioner answered in favor of the assessee. He replied that yes, exemption is applicable to you, and in support of his argument, Development Commissioner also give reference to correspondence with Ministry of Commerce. So Development Commissioner said that exemption is applicable to you, and in support of what he says, he also gave the reference of the correspondence with Ministry of Commerce. Based on this, SSC claimed the exemption, and subsequently it was held that exemption is actually not applicable. Now here, whether SSC has acted bona fide, I think I already answered that question. If SSC has exercised due diligence of writing to one of the government authorities, namely Development Commissioner, and based on Development Commissioner's opinion, which again was based on some information received from Ministry of Commerce, if SSC has opted the exemption, I think is very, very bona fide, and that is what is held in this case law. It was held in Univert Textiles Limited 2013 Supreme Court. The Supreme Court held that mere non-payment of duties could not be equated with collusion or willful misstatement or suppression of facts, as then there would be no form of non-payment which would amount to ordinary default. The Apex Court opined that something more must be shown to constitute the act of SSC as to fit for the applicability of the proviso. If department wants to invoke extended period of limitation, department will have to prove fraud. Here, SSC is absolutely bona fide. Extended period of limitation cannot be invoked. Please read Univert Textiles Limited 2013 Supreme Court.
I am on page number 28, Neeraj Jhanzi 2014 Supreme Court. Very simple case law. Actually, here adjudication order was passed by adjudication officer from Kanpur. SSC wanted to go in appeal. Via jurisdiction, this was under the jurisdiction of Allahabad High Court. But SSC filed appeal with Delhi High Court. Reason must be forum shopping. Delhi High Court was more favorable on the issues involved. This is called as forum shopping. So, I'll repeat, jurisdiction officer was from Kanpur. Actually, that appeal should have lied to Allahabad High Court. But instead of that, by doing forum shopping, SSC filed appeal with Delhi High Court. Revenue objected to that. So, Delhi High Court rejected the appeal. Now, SSC has filed the appeal back. He has come back and now he has filed the appeal with Allahabad High Court. By that time, it is time bar. Whether SSC's act are bona fide and whether delay can be condoned. And the answer is no. That is the decision here. Let us read it. What is held? The special leave petition dismissed. The very filing of writ petition by the petitioner in Delhi High Court against the order in origin passed by Commissioner of Customs Kanpur indicated that petitioner had taken chance in approaching the High Court in Delhi, which had no territorial jurisdiction in the matter. The filing of writ petition before Delhi High Court was not act at all of bona fide. Please understand what must have happened. So, when SSC went to Allahabad High Court, Allahabad High Court rejected based on limitation. So SSC made writ petition to Supreme Court ki this is injustice to me. But then Supreme Court said you have done forum shopping, you have went to wrong jurisdictional High Court, that is not bona fide, there is nothing bona fide in this case, and special leave petition was rejected by Supreme Court. That is the case law, Neeraj Jhanzi 2014 Supreme Court.
Next case law, absolutely accept it as fact-based case law. Even without this case law, I am sure you would have given the same answer, but still accept it as fact-based case law. It is Margara Industries Limited 2013 Allahabad. The question is, can delay in filing appeal to CSTAT due to mistake of the counsel of the appellant be condoned? Here in this case, appeal was filed late and it was due to a mistake of the counsel of the appellant. In fact, that counsel has already submitted an affidavit with the court accepting that the delay is absolutely due to his mistakes. Whether in that case, whether CSTAT should condone the delay. It was held, the High Court held that tribunal ought to have taken lenient view in this matter as the appellant was not going to gain anything by not filing the appeal and the reason for delay in filing the appeal as given by the appellant was the mistake of its counsel who had also filed this personal affidavit. If the counsel in his personal affidavit has already submitted to the court that delay was only because of his mistake and by not filing the appeal, if SIC is not going to gain anything, the delay should be condoned. That is what Margara Industries Limited, 2013, Allahabad. Next case law is Rishirup Polymers Limited, 2013, Mumbai. How does appeal move in indirect taxes? In classroom condition, we have always studied this. First appeal will lie with Commissioner Appeals, second with CSTAT, third with High Court and next with Supreme Court. And if the issue involved is about classification or valuation, High Court will be bypassed. This is one portion. Second portion that we have also studied is 9C. In the classroom condition also, we have already studied this, that if 9C, if anti-dumping duty is charged on an SSE and if SSE is aggrieved by anti-dumping duty, he can file appeal to CSTAT and fees 15,000 court fees will be paid and his appeal will be heard by CSTAT. So I'll repeat, Director General has put anti-dumping duty on a product, but exporter SSE is aggrieved by that. He thinks that okay, anti-dumping duty is due, but you have put more anti-dumping duty than necessary. If SSE is aggrieved by anti-dumping duty, what is the remedy available to him? He can make an appeal to CSTAT. Now, SSE went to CSTAT. CSTAT gave order against the SSE. What was the next remedy available to the SSE? Next remedy available to SSE, if issue was not regarding classification or valuation, he should have gone to High Court and from there he should have gone to Supreme Court. But if issue was because of classification or valuation issues against the CSTAT order, SSE should have gone to Supreme Court. SSE didn't do both the things. Instead of that, he filed writ to the High Court. Please understand, if no other legal remedy is available and if SSE is of the opinion that gross injustice has taken place in his case, then final last option available is making writ to High Court or Supreme Court. But please understand, writ to High Court or Supreme Court can be made only if no other legal remedy is available. If CSTAT has given negative order against anti-dumping duty, there is a legal remedy available of going either to High Court in normal appeal or going to Supreme Court in normal appeal. So when alternative legal remedy is available, writ is not the option. That is what is held here. It was held in Rishirup Polymers Private Limited, 2013, Mumbai. It was held, the High Court therefore held, it would not be appropriate for it to exercise the jurisdiction under Article 226 of the Constitution, that is writ, since the alternate remedy by way of an appeal was available in accordance with the law. The High Court thus dismissed the petition, leaving it open to the SSE to take recourse to the appellate remedy. When alternative remedy is available of going to High Court or Supreme Court in the normal appeal, writ will not be allowed. That is the case law. Rishirup Polymers Private Limited, 2013, Mumbai. Next case law is Dinesh Chajjar, 2014, Karnataka. It has already come in May 2015 attempt. But let us understand this. Before we understand, some background. If you remember, under excise, show cause notice is issued under 11A. If SSE has not levied, not paid, short levied, short paid, or erroneously refunded, then show cause notice can be issued under 11A. Uska parallel section tha service tax mein section 73. If non-levy, non-payment, short levy, short payment or erroneous refund of service tax is there, if officer is of that opinion, then he can issue show cause notice demanding service tax under 73. Show cause notice will be issued under section 73. Uska custom ka parallel section hai 28. On plain reading of 28, it is quite clear that if importer, mark the word importer, if importer, according to officer, if importer has non-levy not paid, short levy or short paid, or has taken erroneous refund, then under section 28, show cause notice be issued under Customs Act demanding the duty. So, one point, very important point to be noted, under section 28, show cause notice can be issued to the importer and show cause notice can be for demand of import duty. I'll repeat important word once again. Under section 28, show cause notice can be issued only to the importer. That was about section 28. Now, second point. If you remember, some goods are, according to officer, if some goods are liable for confiscation, first officer seize those goods under section 110. Seizure is only taking away the physical custody of the goods, but title still remains with the officer. Then under section 124, issue of show cause notice will be done. Show cause notice will be issued, opportunity of being heard will be given to the assessee, and depending on the credentials, confiscation order will be passed. If goods are confiscated, under section 125, officer will give option to the assessee demanding premium in lieu of confiscation. But please understand, we can reach to 125, section 125, only if goods are seized first, because first goods are to be seized under section 110, then under section 124 they can be confiscated, and then under section 125 premium in lieu of confiscation along with custom duty can be demanded. So I have made two points here. Under 28, show cause notice demanding customs duty can be only issued to an importer. Under section 125, custom duty can be demanded only if goods are seized and confiscated. Here, can custom duty be demanded under section 28 and or section 125(2) of the Customs Act from the person dealing in smuggled goods? So he is neither importer, and especially when no such goods are seized from him, neither the goods are seized, so 125 is not applicable. He is not an importer, so section 28 is not applicable. That is the decision. It was held in Dinesh Chhajjar 2014, Karnataka. It was held, High Court held, the tribunal was justified in holding that no duty is levable against the assessee as he is neither the importer nor the owner of the goods or was not in possession of any goods. That is the case law, Dinesh Chhajjar 2014, Karnataka. Next case law is KSJ Metal Impex Private Limited 2013, Madras. Before we read this, if you remember, in service tax, exemptions are issued under 93, 93.1 and 93.2. Uska parallel section hai excise mein, section 5A1 and 5A2, or uska parallel hai customs mein, section 25.1 and 25.2. All of them are copy paste of each other, almost a copy paste. Of course, here the reference is to the service, here the reference is the goods, etc. But my point here, exemption notifications in Customs Act are issued under section 25.1 and 25.2. One of the exemption notification which we have already studied in the classroom was 102 of 2007. And if you remember, it was about 3.5. If you remember this, I am the importer and I am also a trader. So when I clear the goods from customs, first I will pay all import duties. Import duties will include BCD, 3.1, EC of custom, SHEC of custom and 3.5. I will pay all these duties and then I will clear it from the customs. Because I am a trader, subsequently I will sell off those goods in DTA market. When I sell the goods on selling price, I will be paying VAT. Because this second transaction is a local sale, this will attract VAT. This will amount to double VAT, and that is why 102 of 2007 says that subject to completion of procedure, if you are an importer trader and in the second transaction if you are paying the VAT, with the time limit of 1 year, 3-5 will be refunded, of course subject to completion of certain processes. So that is exemption issued under section 25 of Customs Act. I'll repeat, what is this we have studied just now is an exemption notification, and exemption notifications are issued under section 25 of Customs Act, and this particular exemption number is 102 of 2007. That is one issue. Secondly, if you are of the opinion in customs, if you are of the opinion that some refund is due to you, excise 11B. If you remember, in excise, if you think some refund is due to you, you apply for refund under section 11B, and if refund is given late to you, you get it with interest under section 11BB. In service tax, because of section 83, same sections as it is were applicable to service tax also. So in excise or in service tax, if you are eligible for refund, you are supposed to make an application under section 11B, and if you have been given refund late beyond acceptable limit, then you are getting it with interest under section 11BB. Uska Customs Act ka parallel section hai, section 27. Under customs, if you think that refund is due to you, you will make an application under section 27, and if refund is due and it is given beyond acceptable time limit, then it will be always given with interest. That is the provisions written in section 27. Here, SSE was entitled for refund of 3-5. But department gave it very late. Please understand, the importer trader who was entitled for refund of 3-5 got his refund, but he got it very late. Now whether interest is payable? And the answer is yes. Just because exemption notification is silent on this issue, department cannot delay the refund and still not pay the interest. Please understand, though the exemption notification is silent on issue, still, whenever refund is given and if it is given late, always provisions of section 27 will become applicable and the refund will be payable with interest. That is what is the decision. KSJ Metal Impacts Private Limited, 2013, Madras. I will read that decision for you. It will be misconception of the provisions of Customs Act 1962 to state that notification issued under section 25 of Customs Act does not have any specific provision for interest on delay. Just because exemption notification is silent on issue, that does not mean that interest is not payable. If section 26 is loud and clear that whenever refund is given late, it is always to be given with interest, it will be equally applicable to refund given because of some exemption notification. That is the case law. Please study KSJ Metal Impacts Private Limited, 2013, Madras.
I am on page 29, Parimal Ray, 2015, Calcutta. If by mistake you have paid excess import duty, then you can get refund of that and you can make application under section 27, and for section 27 the time bar is of 1 year. It is parallel section almost to section 11B kind of. Time bar is applicable. Time bar is, if application is not made within 1 year, it is time bar. Here, SSE has paid import duty, but actually no import duty was payable at all. He has paid some duty by mistake, and now he has made application for refund. Application for refund he has made after period of limitation. Whether period of limitation, which is applicable to pay excess duty paid, whether it will be also applicable to amount which is paid by mistake, that is the question. I'll read the discussion for you. The provisions of section 27 applies only when there is overpayment of duty or interest under Customs Act. If what you have paid is excess duty or excess interest, then section 27 and its limitation becomes applicable. Tunnel boring machines imported were not excisable to any duty, not liable for any duty. Some paid to the exchange, to the revenue by them was not duty or excess duty. What you have paid was not by character of duty or excess duty. It is simply wrong money paid into government account. the money received by government could not be appropriated, be called, could not be appropriately be called money paid by, the money received by government could more appropriately be called money paid by mistake by one person to another, and which other person is under obligation to repay under section 72 of Indian Contract Act. The obligation was a continuing obligation. When a wrong is continuing, there is no limitation for institution of suit complaining about it. If it is excess duty paid, then section 27 will become applicable and limitation will be applicable. But if it is wrong amount paid by somebody, let it be some amount paid by any person to any other person, that other person will always have to return it, including government. So if you have paid some amount wrongly to government, that is not, cannot be described as excess duty paid. It can be described as wrong amount paid to government. And then under contract act, government will have to return that money to the person, and no limitation will become applicable, and that is the decision held refund due. I'll read the decision. The law of limitation under Customs Act is applicable to duty or interest paid under the act. However, any sum paid to the revenue by the assessee is not duty or excess duty, but it is simply money paid, wrong money paid into government, and you will have to refund it. That is the case law number 29, Parimal Ray 2015.
Next case law is very simple case law, and I have nothing much to value add. It is M. Ambalal and Company 2010 Supreme Court. It has already come in May 2012 attempt. Please understand, there is a difference between imported goods and smuggled goods, and they have been clearly defined under Customs Act. And the exemptions available or treatment available to imported goods will not be available to smuggled goods. If same treatment was to be given both to imported goods as well as to smuggled goods, then there should not have been two separate definitions. Here, what is held, the smuggled goods could not be considered as imported goods for the purpose of benefit of exemption notification. It opined that if smuggled goods and imported goods were to be treated as the same, then there would have been no need for two different definitions under Customs Act 1962. Hence, it held that it would be contrary to the purpose of exemption notification to give the benefit meant for imported goods to smuggled goods. Imported goods and smuggled goods are entirely different. Exemptions available to imported goods will not be extended to smuggled goods. M. Ambalal and Company, 2010 Supreme Court. Next case law is again a very obvious case law. We have already studied about it in the classroom condition. When goods are seized, they are seized, if officer is of the opinion that some goods are liable for confiscation, first thing he will do is seize those goods under section 110. When the goods are seized, along with that, some documents and records also may be seized. Now officer will start with the proceedings. While doing the proceedings, if assessee requires the copies of those documents and records which have been seized, is it an obligation of the officer to supply those copies to the assessee? Obvious answer, based on natural principle also, the yes, and it is already well written in 110.4. So based on that, it was held, the High Court held that from the language of 110.4, it was apparent that custom officer were mandatorily required to make available the copies asked for it by the party concerned, who had the choice of either asking for the documents or seeking extract, and not the officer. If any document was seized during the course of any action by an officer and relatable to the provisions of Customs Act, that officer was bound to make available copies of those documents. The denial by the revenue to make the documents available was clearly an act without jurisdiction. Court ordered the department to make the copies available to the assessee. Absolutely, we already discussed this case law when in the classroom condition. 110, officer seizes the goods. Along with that, if he had seized some documents and record, and the proceedings which have been started against the assessee, for that, if those documents and records are required, it is already well written in 110.4 that department will have to make those copies available to the SSE. Manish Lalit Kumar Bhavishi, 2011, Bombay. Next case law is Hemal K. Shah, 2012, GOI. So it is about Section 80 of Customs Act, which we have already discussed in the classroom. I'll just remind you what Section 80 was all about. Suppose some importer is coming from abroad and he has some dutiable goods with him. Now what will happen? He will have to walk through Red Channel, pay the duty. But he is only a tourist. For example, he has come to India only for few days and those goods which he is carrying are not required by him in India. They are for his own consumption with when he reaches his own country. So, to repeat, one importer is coming to India and he has some dutiable goods. One option to declare it, to walk through Red Channel, to declare those goods, to pay the duty and while going back to take duty drawback, which is a cumbersome procedure. Instead of that, there is one facility given by Section 80. Importer can declare his goods and he will allow the officer to detain the goods. Officer will take away those goods, they will not be cleared for home consumption. Officer will take away those goods, it will be kept in the lockers and while going back, importer can collect the goods. That was the facility given by Section 80. Section 80 just not required here in this case law. Section 80 has extended this facility to two types of goods, one dutiable goods or one prohibited goods. We are not concerned with prohibited goods here, but certainly under Section 80, if I am a tourist, I am coming to India, I have some dutiable goods, I can declare it to the officer, I will not clear it for home consumption, I will keep it in lock and key of customs department, I will enter India without those goods, I will enjoy my stay. While going back, I will collect my goods and then I can go away. This is the facility given by Section 80. But here, please understand, this facility is available only to the declared goods which officially we allowed Customs Department to detain. Here was the different case. Mr. Hemal K. Shah was walking through customs area and was found to be having some goods which were very high duty item goods. So, officer confiscated goods, smuggling charges were put on Mr. Hemal K. Shah. Now, he applied to export of these goods under Section 80 and Commissioner Appeal allowed export of these goods under Section 80 on payment of premium in lieu of confiscation. Whether Hemal K. Shah can be allowed to do so? Please understand, only way of re-exporting these goods was like this. First, he was found while smuggling the goods. So, officer will issue show cause notice. He will confiscate the goods. First, he will seize the goods. Then, he will issue show cause notice. He will confiscate the goods. Then, he will give option to pay premium in lieu of confiscation. Hemal K. Shah can pay that premium in lieu of confiscation. He can release the goods. Then, still if he wants to export it, he can file shipping bill and then goods can be exported. Whether special facility given under Section 80 to re-export the goods, can it be extended to smuggle goods? And the answer is no. Section 80 is not talking about it. That is the case law. It was held. Revisionary authorities decision. It was revision application and that is why it is central government. Revisionary authorities decision. The government noted that passenger had grossly misdeclared the goods with the intention to evade the duty and to smuggle the goods in India. As per provisions of Section 80 of the Customs Act 1962, when the baggage of the passenger contains article which is dutiable or prohibited, in respect of which declaration is made under Section 77, proper officer on request of the passenger can detain such articles for the purpose of being returned to him on his leaving India. Since the passenger has neither made true declaration nor requested detention of the goods for re-export before custom authorities at the time of arrival at the airport, the re-export of such said goods could not be allowed under Section 80. Section 80 is a special facility. While arriving, if you have made a declaration and if you have allowed custom department officially to detain the goods, that is when Section 80 facility is available. It is not available to smuggle goods. That is the case law. Hemal K. Shah, 2012, Government of India. Next decision is Caravel Logistics 2013 Madras. First we have to understand two sections. One is section 116. If it is found that goods are improperly imported by person in charge, then he is liable for confiscation and penalty proceedings. That is section 116, a very obvious section. If goods are found to be improperly imported by person in charge, then he is the person who is responsible for confiscation as well as penalties. Also, knowledge of one more section is required, and that is section 148. Section 148 says that person in charge, if instead of doing all those activities himself, like filing of import general manifest and dealing with the custom authorities, if instead of person in charge doing those activities himself, if he has appointed an agent, then section 148 says all the obligations, including procedural obligations, including confiscation obligations and including penalty obligations, agent will be equally responsible for the same. So section 148 says, section 148 provides that the agent appointed by person in charge of the conveyance and any person who represent himself to any officer of custom as an agent of such person in charge is held to be liable for fulfillment in respect of the matters in question of all obligations imposed on such a person in charge by or under this act and to penalties and confiscation. Once you have been appointed as agent by person in charge and you start representing to customs department as agent of person in charge, then section 148 has made that agent equally liable to all liabilities of person in charge, including confiscation of goods and penalty. And that is exactly is the question: can penalty for short landing of the goods imposed be imposed on steamer agent of a vessel if he files the IGM, deals with the goods at different stages of shipment and conducts all affairs in compliance with the provisions of Customs Act? If steamer agent has entered the shoes of person in charge and all formalities including filing of IGM etc., if he is doing, whether he will become equally liable for confiscation and penalty? Answer is obviously yes. Ek bar I will read that decision. Held, the High Court held that joint reading of section 231 is definition of person in charge, 116 is improperly import of goods, and 148 is responsibilities of custom house of the steamer agent. Court bolta hai, having read them all together, makes it clear that in case of short landing of the goods, if penalty is to be imposed on person in charge of a conveyance vessel, it can also be imposed on the agent appointed by him. I think I have already explained this point to you. Please read Caravel Logistics 2013 Madras. Is Akanksha Synthetics Private Limited, it is a 2014 case law. Many things out of this we have already discussed in classroom condition. First, you remember section 110. If officer is of the opinion that some goods are liable for confiscation, first thing he will do is to seize the goods under section 110. Now suppose there is one importer and his goods are seized. Then officer will start proceedings under 124. Officer under 124.1 will issue show cause notice, opportunity of being heard will be given and goods will be confiscated. But suppose you are urgently in the need of the goods. There is one option available to you which was given by section 110A. What you can do, you can tell the officer, sir, my goods are seized, but I need those goods very badly. You continue with the procedure, but I am giving you bond. Under 110A, importer can give bond, and based on bonds, goods can be released. So point I will repeat once again. Under section 110, if importer goods are confiscated and if he is in urgent need of the goods, without waiting for the procedure, he can execute bond under section 110A, and on execution of bond, those goods will be released. That is one aspect to it. But then there is another aspect which is also written in 110.2. 110.2 says if goods are seized, and no proceedings have been started under 124. 124 is confiscation proceedings. If goods are seized and no proceedings have been started under 124 and 6 months are over, department will have to release the goods to the importer. Point to be noted, if within 6 months or time extended by the commissioner, if confiscation proceedings have not been started, department will have to return the goods. Now, let us understand the case law. SAC ke goods the 110 ke andar wo seize ho gaye. Meanwhile, he was urgently in the need of the goods. So, under 110A, he executed the bond and order was issued to release the goods. Order was issued to release the goods. The goods are yet not released, but meanwhile, 6 months period is over. I'll repeat, SAC's goods are seized under 110A. He has applied for release of the goods. He has executed the bond also. Release order is also passed. The goods are yet not released. It is in process, but meanwhile, 6 months are over. Now, please tell me whether goods need to be returned to the SAC without execution of bond? Yes, because 110.2 is loud and clear. If 6 months are over from the date of seizure, department without any procedure will have to return the goods. The procedure of 110A is no more required, and that is exactly the case law. It was held, the remedy of provisional release is independent of remedy of claiming unconditional release. If 6 months are over from date of seizure, goods stand unconditionally released, bond execution formalities are not required. These goods will now get status of not the one which is released under the bond, but will get status of unconditional released. The remedy of provisional release is independent of remedy of claiming unconditional release. In the absence of issuance of any valid show cause notice during the period of limitation 6 months or extended limitation prescribed under 110.2 of the Customs Act. If period of 6 months is over, goods stand released unconditionally, they are not been released under bond. That is the case law, Akanksha Syntex Private Limited, it is 2013 case law.
This is the last case law now, page number 30, Purushottam Jajodia, 2014. The question is whether mere dispatch of notice under section 124A would imply that a notice was given within the meaning of section 124A and section 110.2 of the said Customs Act. Under customs procedures lectures, we have studied both these sections. If according to officer, some goods are liable for confiscation, first thing he will do is he will seize the goods. Please understand, seizure is he is just taking away the goods physically. The title still remains with the importer. So first step, seizure of the goods, and 110.1 is talking about that. 110.1 says, if some goods are liable for confiscation, officer will go and seize those goods. Acha, 110.1 mein proviso bhi hai. Seizure can be either physical seizure or constructive seizure. For example, goods is 10 lakh liters of chemical X which is put in a big storeroom. It is not possible for the officer to physically take it away. Officer will seal that storeroom and issue letter to the importer, you cannot touch these goods unless I give the permission. So 110.1 is talking about seizure of the goods, and seizure can be physical seizure or seizure can be constructive seizure. Having said that, now officer will, having seized the goods, officer will start confiscation proceedings under section 124. 124 ke andar likha hai, 124ABC. 124A mein likha hai, officer will give show cause notice, he will give opportunity of being heard, and find appropriate, he will confiscate the goods. But 110.2, ko pehle yaad karte hai, 110.2 mein aise likha tha, if confiscation show cause notice is not given within 6 months, officer will have to return the goods. Usme proviso hai, in a particular case, this period of 6 months can be increased by another 6 months. Ek bar 110 pehle padte hai. Here on page number 30, I have reproduced section 110 for you. 110. 1. If the proper officer has reason to believe that any goods are liable for confiscation under this act, he may seize such goods, provided that where it is not practicable to seize any such goods, the proper officer may serve on the owner of the goods an order that he shall not remove, part with, or otherwise deal with the goods except with the previous permission of such officer. So 110.1, officer will seize the goods. 110.2, where any goods are seized under subsection 1, but notice under section 124, proposing confiscation in respect thereof is not given within 6 months of seizure, goods shall be returned to the person. Proviso that this period of 6 months can be increased by another 6 months. That was section 110. Now we try to read section 124, which is confiscation proceedings. And first step of confiscation is issue of is show cause notice. Let us read the word 124 mein kya use kiya hai word issue ki serve. Section 124. Any confiscation order or penalty order shall be passed only after the owner of the goods or such person is given notice in writing. So here word likha hai given. 110.2 and 124, both the sections read together, whether show cause notice is to be issued or whether it is to be served. The word given, what does it mean? Held. The department was directed to release the goods seized. Since the petitioner did not receive the notice, iska matlab hai, issue of notice is not sufficient for these sections. It has to be served because both the sections word use is given. That is the decision here. That is the last case law, which is Purushottam Jajodia 2014.
The last case law is Santosh Handloom's 2016 Delhi. In case of seizure of goods under section 110 of Customs Act, can the show cause notice required to be issued under section 124 within 6 months of seizure be issued to custom house agent, custom house broker of the importer instead of importer himself? If you remember, goods are seized if officer has reason to believe that some goods are liable for confiscation. Under section 110, first he will seize the goods. That is only physically the goods are taken away, but title is still with the importer. Having seized the goods, within 6 months, officer will start confiscation proceedings, and those proceedings are by under section 124, and the proceedings start with issue of show cause notice. Now, whether that show cause notice is to be served on importer only or it can be served on custom house agent also. Some of the facts are like this. Finance Act 2012 has amended section 153 of Customs Act, and categorically it is written in that section that such a notice is served to the importer or his authorized agent but not to custom house agent. So that is one very clear provision. In point number 1 of discussion I have given that provision. Finance Act 2012 has amended section 153 of Customs Act to do away with service of order, decision, summons and notices on agent. The custom house broker is an agent who operates under special contract, and section 153 is loud and clear. Show cause notice etc. cannot be served on agent, it has to be served on importer only. Also, if you read custom broker regulations, custom broker regulation gives the job profile of custom house agent. He is supposed to perform all the functions which are done in ordinary course of business to clear the goods from customs. There, accepting summons etc. kind of provisions are not there. So even custom broker regulations also don't allow the receipt of notice by custom house agent. In a particular case, if a particular principal has given special authority to custom house agent, then custom house agent can receive the notice. But then while serving on him the notice, department will have to ask those documents. What are the documents that you have been authorized to receive the notice? If custom house agent is able to produce those documents, now the notice can be served on him. In this case,
custom department has not asked for any such documents. Reading all that in toto, it was held that High Court held that show cause notice served on custom broker is not tenable in law. In point number 3 I have written, in case custom house agent represents that he has such an authority, he would have to produce the same before the concerned statutory authority. In a particular case, if custom house agent claims that he has authority to receive such a notice, he will have to give evidence to the authority. Point number 4 I have written, in given case, department neither sought production of any authority from custom house agent nor did custom house agent supply any such document to the custom authorities, which could in the ordinary course had persuaded the department to serve the notice on CHA. In ordinary course, section 153 compliance is expected from the department and they can serve the notice only to the importer and not to his agent. Please complete Santosh Handlooms 2016 Delhi High Court. These are the 10 case laws from RTP November 2016.
Next case law, I have nothing to value add. It is hopeless case law. Sanghvi Reconditioners Private Limited 2010 Supreme Court. In case of settlement commission's order, can the SSC be permitted to accept what is favorable to them and reject what is not? Is it possible that settlement commission has given the order, part of it is positive for you, accept it, and part of it is negative for you, you reject it? Is it possible? Obvious answer is no. It was held, the apex court held, that the application under 127B of Customs Act 1962 is maintainable only if duty liability is disclosed. The disclosure contemplated is in the nature of voluntary disclosure of concealed additional custom duty. Court further opined that having opted to get their custom duty liabilities settled by settlement commission, the appellant could not be permitted to dissect the settlement commission's order with the view to accept what is favorable to them and reject what is not. Once settlement commission order has come, you have to accept it as it is. You cannot dissect it, divide it into two parts and accept part of the order and reject part of the order. That is not possible. Sanghvi Reconditioners Private Limited 2010 Supreme Court. Next decision is Saurashtra Cement Limited 2013 Gujarat. Once settlement commission order comes, it is final order. But whether writ can be made to High Court against settlement commission order, and the answer is yes. But please understand, the scope of High Court is restricted to see whether principle of natural justice was followed, whether the procedure laid down which settlement commission is supposed to follow, whether that procedure has been followed properly. High Court is not going to get into the issues involved and revisit the arguments and come out with a decision on that. The High Court's intervention will be restricted to see to it that settlement commission has not caused any gross natural injustice and settlement commission has followed all the procedures which settlement commission is supposed to follow. The scope of the writ is restricted to that extent. Other than that, settlement commission order is always final. That is what is held the High Court observations and decision. While examining the scope of judicial review in relation to decision of settlement commission, the High Court noted, although the decision of settlement commission is final, finality clause would not exclude the jurisdiction of High Court under Article 226 of the Constitution, that is making writ to the High Court. Yes, against settlement commission also, though it is final, but still option of making writ is still available to the SSC or that of the Supreme Court under Article 32 or 136 of the Constitution. The court would ordinarily interfere in the settlement commission. The court would ordinarily interfere if the settlement commission has acted without jurisdiction vested in it, or the decision is wholly arbitrary or perverse or malafide or is against principle of natural justice, or when such decision is ultra vires to the act or the same is based on irrelevant consideration. The court, however, pronounced that the scope of court's inquiry against the decision of the settlement commission is very narrow. The judicial review is concerned with the decision making process and not with the decision of the settlement commission. Yes, settlement commission decision, though it is final, but still writ can be made to the High Court or Supreme Court, but jurisdiction of High Court and Supreme Court will be not revisiting the arguments and coming out with the decision, but only to check whether settlement commission had jurisdiction over this issue, that is one, whether any gross injustice has taken place, or whether settlement commission has followed all the procedures properly. That is the decision. A very interesting situation. Saurashtra Cement Limited, 2013, Gujarat. Under Customs Act, you can go to the settlement commission if there is a pending case. It takes character of pending case moment officer has issued show cause notice, and it will keep the character of pending case till adjudication order has been passed. So moment show cause notice is issued and before adjudication order is passed, if the show cause notice is regarding recovery of custom duty or refund thereof, then it takes the character of the case. In one of the decisions, Supreme Court has already given the decision. The decision was Liberty India versus Commissioner of Income Tax 2009 Supreme Court, where the Supreme Court has already given the decision that Supreme Court observed that drawback is nothing but remission of duty on account of statutory provisions. In other words, duty drawback is nothing but remission of customs duty. Now, the question is, does the settlement commission have jurisdiction to settle cases relating to drawback? Answer is yes. I will give you answer in 3-4 steps once again. First of all, you can go to settlement if it's a pending case. That is, from the time show cause notice is issued till adjudication order is passed, it is character, having character of a pending case. In that period, you can always go to settlement. If the case is regarding custom duty or refund thereof, then it becomes the case and then doors of settlement commission are open. Now, whether drawback is also a customs duty, and the answer is yes, it is already established in Supreme Court's case of Liberty India Limited. So drawback is nothing but remission of customs duty. So it is also a case for the purpose of settlement commission, and settlement commission has no doubt jurisdiction on drawback case. That is what is held. The High Court thus concluded that duty drawback or claim of duty drawback is nothing but a claim for refund of duty as per the statutory schemes framed by the Government of India or in exercise of statutory powers under the provisions of the Act. Thus, the High Court held that Settlement Commission has jurisdiction to deal with the questions relating to recovery of drawback erroneously paid by the revenue. Settlement Commission has jurisdiction over duty drawback cases. That is Union of India versus Settlement Commission 2010, Bombay. Next case is Vishnu M. Haralka 2013, Mumbai. It has already come in November 2015 attempt. Let us read it. First, you try to remember Section 150. Section 150 is about what to do with sale proceeds of auction. If some goods are confiscated or the title has been relinquished to the department, department will always sell off the goods. The sale, if you remember, we have already studied those sections in the syllabus. The sale will be either by auction or by tender or by any other method approved by the importer. Normally, goods will be auctioned. And what happens to the sale proceeds? First, they have been used to meet auction expenses. Then, any freight payable will be adjusted. Then, customs duty will be adjusted. Then, port trust charges will be adjusted. Then, any amount, other amount due to central government will be adjusted. And balance, if any, will be given to the importer. Here, custom authorities auction the goods. But the amount which was after adjusting all other adjustments like custom duty, etc., whatever amount that was payable to the importer was given late. Now, whether interest is to be paid? And the answer is absolutely yes. For whatever reason, some amount due to the importer, if it is given late, always it should be given with interest, otherwise it is against natural justice, and that is exactly what is held. It was held that the High Court held that department cannot plead that Customs Act 1962 provides for the payment of interest only in respect of refund of duty and interest, and hence assessee would not be entitled to interest on balance of sale proceeds which were directed to be paid by settlement commission. The High Court clarified that acceptance of such submission would mean that despite an order of the competent authority directing the department to grant the refund, the department can wait for extraordinarily long period to grant the refund. The High Court directed department to pay interest from the date of approval of the proposal for sanctioning the refund. For whatever reason, any amount payable to the importer, if it is given late beyond acceptable limits, always it will be required to pay, to be paid with interest. And that is Vishnu M. Haralka, 2013, Mumbai. Next case law is Anita Grover. This is the last case law, Anita Grover, 2013, Delhi. First understand, Section 11 of Central Excise Act, if you remember, we have studied thoroughly in the classroom condition, which was coercive method of recovery. Uska parallel section in service tax was Section 87. Again, coercive method of recovery. Uska parallel section in Customs Act is 142. If assessee's default continues beyond acceptable limit, then officer will proceed under Section 142 by coercive method, and he will try to recover that amount from the assessee. If you remember the order, the last order was in fact in that writing a certificate to the collector having jurisdiction over residence of the assessee, and collector will proceed to recover it as if it is recovery of land revenue. That is what I am talking about, the coercive method of recovery, which twice in the classroom we have studied, once under Section 11 for excise and once under Section 87 under service tax, copy paste section in Customs 142. But the point is, coercive method of recovery can be started against service provider or person, other person liable to pay service tax, or against manufacturer, or here against the assessee. But there are provisions in Income Tax Act and there are provisions in VAT Act where if assessee is not paying, for example, assessee is a company, then whether same recovery mechanism can it be continued against directors or partners? As far as income tax is concerned or as far as VAT laws are concerned, there are provisions there that for the default even partners or directors' assets can be subjected to, but there are no corresponding provisions in Section 142. In absence of such provisions in Customs Act, director of the company, his personal assets cannot be subjected for recovery action. That is the case law. I am reading the answer, Anita Grover, 2013, Delhi. The court held that since the company was not being wound up, the juristic personality, the company and the former directors would certainly be separate, and the dues recoverable from former could not, in the absence of statutory provisions, be recovered from the latter. There was no provision in Customs Act 1962 corresponding to Section 179 of Income Tax Act or Section 18 of Central Sales Tax Act, which might enable the revenue authorities to proceed against directors of the company who were not defaulters. There may be corresponding provisions in Income Tax Act or VAT Act where department can proceed to the directors, but no corresponding provisions in Section 142. So directors' personal asset cannot be subjected to recovery proceedings. Anita Grover, 2013, Delhi. Please try to complete them. Try to have a look at my detailed study material also, and have a look at my summary page also. Summary page is only 6 pages. Decide what is more convenient for you. Thank you.